interesting. You know, one of the biggest fears people have is the fear of criticism, what other people are thinking about you. And the real reality is no one's thinking about us. They're dealing with their own situations, right? How do you handle criticism of what other people think in your daily activity?
Well, you know, I just am doing a lot of personal, you know, development work. You know, I've learned communication skills. And the majority of us do not communicate. We just vomit all over each other. And so what I've learned through that is how to recreate people's communication. And it really disappears the whatever the upset is or the criticism or however it's landing as a disempowering conversation. So it's just, yeah, get in the world and really recreate whatever it is they're dealing with. And then it vanishes. It absolutely disappears. You know, it's very rare that I have criticism in my life, which is it's actually an amazing thing. It's a lot of good feedback coming my way because A, I put out that good feedback, so of course law of attraction, right? So what you put out is what you get. And then I'm just a stand for people being heard. So if people have a criticism about me, I want to hear it. I want to hear how I can improve what's going on over there with you so we can come together and create love and affinity.
That is a fantastic answer. Fantastic. It's interesting, one of my mentors who was in the room earlier, his name's Dave Corbin, he wrote a book called Illuminate. It means that you've got to put a spotlight on what ails us. I remember when I had a book review on Amazon, and all these great things, but one of them said, it sucks. And so I sent an email to 35,000 people, says, hey, everyone loves my book. One guy says, it sucks. What do you think? But by putting that spotlight, it got rid of it. And it was really interesting, that point of view. I got this question. When you're handled adversity, how is it that you handle it? Do you have a reset mode or do you go into a mantra? What do you do, Indy?
You know what, it's interesting because something that I frequently talk about is using adversity for your advancement. Because I liken adversity to that friend that you don't want but you need. She's like that girlfriend or guy friend or romance guy, you know, for the guys out there. Who, you know, she stops by, she comes unannounced, you know, she doesn't tell you when she's showing up. And she breaks down the door, and the thing about it is, she's there to tell you things that you don't see about yourself. That your friends, you know, because you only tell your friends a little bit of what's really going on, like, girl, I can't believe, you're not going to believe what he did to me. But then, adversity already knows, no, but what did you do? You know what I mean? Like, adversity's like, no, let's talk about your part in it. Your girlfriends aren't going to do that. Your girlfriend's like, I told you not to. I told you, you know, but an adversity will come and ask you questions like, okay, so when he said he was leaving, was it because you did X, Y, and Z? Because you didn't tell that part. Or let's go back, you know, 2 months ago when you said this to him and then that plant exceeds, you didn't tell that part. And then so it makes you do introspective work if you allow it. But some people sit in their adversity because they want to suck their thumbs and be like, oh my God, I can't believe it. But no, adversity is there to say, hey, check it out. It's something you can learn. Why are you where are you? You know, is it happening because of something external or internal? And whatever it is, you can take it and say, all right, because of that, I'm going to do better. I'm going to be better. I'm going to make better choices. I'm going to move these things out of my way. And I'm going to push forward because it's not leaving until you really be honest, until you're honest with what's happening in the moment. So, yes, adversity, listen. I'm like, bring it on. Show me who I am and let's move on.
Are you sure you worked at Oprah? Lillian, you know, one of the interesting words about personal growth is the growth part, right? And the big question is, what have you learned in the past year that was a growing pain?
Well, yeah, so, you know, recently what's been really opening up for me is, you know, how I relate to myself inside of relationships with men. And so there was things that happened in my past, in my childhood. My parents were in a very physical, abusive relationship. And so, you know, of course, there's what happens and then the story that we make it mean. And so I really made that mean that I don't matter. And so that's been showing up inside of my relationships with men. So you can imagine how that's going. Like, hey, you want to go on a date? I don't matter. I don't matter. I don't matter. That doesn't go too well, right? So I really got that really, you know, clear for myself. And I mean, so much freedom is present now. You know, just the freedom to be able to be with another human being, right? We all have our own version of this going on. So I would say that that's one of my biggest growth spurts, you know, turning 30 this year and really stepping into my power as a female entrepreneur. These things are so important for us to learn and grow is how we can evolve and become extraordinary human beings.
Lillian, I got a question. That word freedom keeps coming up. Yeah. What does it mean to you?
That's a great word. And that's one of my favorite attributes, if you will. because I think if you don't have freedom, you don't have anything. And the truth is, we are all born with innate freedom. We have the power to use our free will to either create things that we want that will give us a benefit, or create things that are a consequence that we're not going to like. But either way, we have that power to create, and we have that freedom to use that free will. So for me, freedom and free will, they're not synonymous, but they go one with each other. And I think that's one of the most valuable things that I possess as a human being, and as a God-given thing.
Now, freedom, George Michael did say it best. So I got a question for you, Tracy. You were talking about the law of attraction, and it's about vibration, whatever you put out comes to be. Well, look, the way a law of attraction really works is you don't get what you want, you get more of what you already are, right? How do you show up to the world right now to tell the world that you're ready for the next step?
So I personally show up through creativity. That's like my gift, my ability to innovate, to invent, to move on. It just gives other people an empowerment and ability to say, hey, I'm good at this too. I can do this too. And so that's just where I choose to reside. And I believe that in a world in which curveballs get thrown at you every single day, and when you get a curve, you don't know what you should do. And the only thing that I think that you can do is relax and do what you do best. And what I do best is create.
I love that. You know, one of the greatest common denominators of powerful people is association. Like, we're a reflection of the people we hang around the most, our attitude, income, lifestyle is the average of the group. How important is it for you to surround yourself with the best like-minded people you can?
I think it's imperative. I think that, you know,
But how do you get rid of the negative naysayers?
How do you get rid of them?
Yeah.
You just don't, I mean, how do you get rid of them? You just don't have them around you. Like, you just, you know, I here's what I think. And my husband and I talk about this all the time. If you're constantly speaking your truth, and you're standing in your truth, and you're secure about who you are, and who God has created you to be, what's in you comes out. And so if you're constantly speaking in a way that is absolutely true to who you are, then you're going to attract that, right? And the people who can't stand it won't be around it. And that is what I found, that the people who are closest to me, we have the same sort of like-mindedness, same sort of core values. We encourage each other, we support each other, because that's naturally what we do with each other. And those who don't, they don't know what to do. They don't. It's like they're like the purple unicorn. Like they get uncomfortable. You know. So I think the bigger question is, if there are negative people in your life, then you need to take a look at you. Because
great.
If they're negative, there's something about you that's allowing it, that's saying it's okay. So then what are you projecting? What are you doing? What's in you? And I think that's a huge, it's a mirror. And I think we have to be honest with that. You know, there were times in my life where I did have people around me who weren't the greatest. And it was because I sought validation through what they thought. So I was the perfect candidate for that. You know, they would pray on me. It's kind of like, oh, you're okay, I'm okay. I'm good. But what was so funny was that I had this exterior confidence. You know, because my mother, you know, raised a very strong African-American woman. My mother was an entrepreneur. You know, she taught me all of that. But within that, there was this thing of like, when everybody said you're great at what you do, it's like, okay, I guess I'm good. You know, and the minute you don't get it, then you're trying to get their validation to say I'm good. So then it's like, well, wait a minute. Do I think I'm good because of this, or is it because of what you think? So I think all of that plays into being clear about who you are, why you are.
Act of clarity. You look like you have a follow-up.
Yeah, you know, I just want to make sure that people realize that, be clear, that you don't need like-minded people who think just like you. You need people who challenge you. Negative naysayers are very different than people who challenge you.
It's true. It's true. And just to piggyback on that, so I think a true friend will do that. Yeah. I think a true friend will be like, hey, girl, check it out. Because I know who you are, and I know your level of integrity, I'm seeing a little bit of something. You know what I mean? But if somebody who is not like-minded in terms of like that core value, they're not gonna call that out. So that's what I mean in terms of like-mindedness, having that same sort of value system to know, all right, we're on the same level, we can hold each other accountable and challenge each other.
Here's a great quote. It says, we all need mirrors to remind us who we are. Olivia, who are you?
You know, Forbes Riley actually has been coming up quite a bit for me.
just being with her yesterday and sharing the stage, it was, it's amazing. I see so much of myself in her, that high energy, spunky, like so committed to making a difference, so genuinely, authentically passionate about people living a transformed, amazing life. Like, that's the only reason I'm on this planet. That's it, you know? And money's great, it's fun. Love playing, traveling, and like that. And she is the embodiment of that. And so I see so much of myself in her. Yeah.
You know, people always talk about their downtime. Like, how you handle your downtime, who is who you are as a person. Lillian, how do you handle your downtime?
You know, my downtime has changed a lot in the last 5 years. I've always been one to pray and meditate and so forth, but probably in the last 5 years, that's something that I really regard as very sacred, and I spend a lot more time where I, not necessarily praying, asking for stuff, but just quieting my mind and being in that open space. And some of the greatest points of clarity that I have had have come not from another human being on the outside telling me, this is what you should do in this challenge, this is what you should do in this particular situation. But it's been in that moment of just being in that quiet stillness where you really have the communication between you and the Creator, and you have that open heart space where you can really allow whatever that needs to come in to actually come in. And then I've had huge ahas. And I believe and I know that because I'm in that space and I've been there very mindfully, intentionally for the last 5 years especially, that some extraordinary things have happened, including the embracing of emotions that normally I would want to bottle up and not have to deal with because they don't feel good. But because I have been willing to open myself up and deal with that in my quiet time instead of being my gay personality, get her done, you know, just like run like the Energizer Bunny and, you know, pull all-nighters, and instead do the opposite and quiet myself down and just be in that stillness. Take the time to, you know, I live by the beach, so I go to the beach a lot and just sit and listen to that quiet, still voice. And I've had incredible insights. And interestingly enough, I have what I like to call God incidences that start to happen in a crazy ass manner. You know, people call them miracles, people can call them serendipity, and they have them here or there. No. People who are close to me who witness a lot of them are like, damn, it's like, holy cow, it's like, how do you do that? And I'm like, I'm not.
So what you call it, instead of coincidence, you call it a
God incident.
God incident.
God incident.
That's a great quote.
That is
great.
It's crazy. Ass.
Hold on a second, I gotta go to GoDaddy and get that real quick. So we only got a couple more minutes, so here's what we're gonna end with. Everyone, tell us your favorite quote that impacted your life. Olivia, you're up.
I'm not here just to make a living, I'm here to make a difference.
Beautiful.
We say pretty much every day, so I live in the startup world, hope is not a plan.
Nice.
My favorite quote is, better to ask and get a no than to never ask and never know. Dream the impossible dream. It's possible.
Man, there's so many.
No pressure.
I would say true purpose is obedience to God. That is my favorite quote, and that is because I truly believe that God has given us everything we need to do exactly what he's called us to do. And if we're obedient to that, then we have a purpose.
Round of applause for our panel, everybody. Thank you so much.
Bring up our next group. I just have to tune in with you right now and raise your hand if you're going to City Gala tomorrow night.
Nice.
Raise your hand if you want to go to City Gala tomorrow night. Yes? Some people were asking about that. We just want to let you know. One more time, City Gala tomorrow night is extraordinary at Walt Disney Concert Hall in downtown LA here, two blocks from where the Grammys going to happen. It's like a Grammys after party, so there's going to be lots of celebs from the Grammys peeking in. And as you may already know, John Travolta, Russell Simmons, Quincy Jones being honored, and then there's the celebrity poker tournament that night. So it's going to be an epic, incredible night. And the ticket to get in there would be $1,500, or you're certainly have sponsorship opportunities. And we also want to let you know, if you are going, make sure you come early, because there's going to be extra high security.